When I was about 12, I said to my mum that when I grew up, I wanted to be a pilot, and she said, you can't do both. She wasn't wrong, but I have managed to fly for about 35 years of my life, and part of the inspiration for me to learn to fly in the first place, those of you who came to my first lecture will know that it was my dad, but also it was some of these ladies that we're going to look at today. That music you heard was Portuguese fado music. It's the, if you like, Portuguese equivalent of the flamenco in Spain. It's often eaten with cheese. There are some rules that port carries with it, and these rules, we're going to laugh about some of them, but as they came in over the years, they've stuck. It's to be sipped, not gulped. It's used for making toasts. The word toast comes from medieval times. In medieval times, what the drink you wear when you were around a big table and you wanted to drink somebody's health. In those days, like we put lemon in a gin and tonic, or if we put an olive in a martini now, they would put a small piece of toast into their drink, a bit like a crouton in some soup. That's what was in your drink when you raised it to declare the health of your friend or whatever it was. Well, that sort of drinking has changed, but the word toast has been left in the vocabulary as to what we do when we drink to somebody's health.
Yeah, and this afternoon, it gives me the great pleasure to introduce you to one of our guest speakers for the cruise. And he has a lot of expertise. He's a social historian and a lot of expertise in his field. So throughout the cruise, you're going to get to know him very, very well. As you can see behind me, the world's greatest air race, 1934. I'm going to introduce you now. Please give him a saga warm welcome to Dr. Michael Fopp.
Thank you very much, Christopher. And welcome, everybody. When I was about 12 years old, I said to my mum, I want to be a pilot when I grow up. And she said, you can't do both. So I became a pilot eventually, but I was a museum director. And I was the director general of the Royal Air Force Museums at Hendon and Cosford for 22 years. And director of the London Transport Museum in Covent Garden before that. So I spent my years, working years, looking after all the things I used to play with when I was a child. Buses, trains, aeroplanes. It was put in place to celebrate the centenary of the state of Victoria and its capital city, Melbourne. In 1934, that city was 100 years old. And they decided they needed to do something, or the civic elders decided they needed to do something to mark that achievement. First of all, let's just explain, because we in Britain take for granted this Gotney Gum Chum phrase, and I use it as a title, but actually, a lot of people from the United States don't understand what it means. Well, the GIs, the government issue, of course, GIs that came to Great Britain, they were so generous and they came with such wonderful things that we hadn't seen for so long that this phrase, got any gum chum, was the first thing they heard from the children. All the children that they met, they said, got any gum chum? Chewing gum. And the answer from the American GI would be, if you've got a sister, mister. But what the men found when they got to England was a totally different country. Most of them had never been out of their state or even their town before they actually were shipped across the Atlantic to somewhere like Greenock in Scotland, and then on a dirty train all the way down to their bases in East Anglia. And their first impressions of our country were not that good, because we had been at war for a couple of years. And the rations that were being eaten, the food, the clothing that was being worn, we looked a pretty scruffy lot. And they had come from a country that the lights were on and we had a blackout. And they arrived primarily during the winter initially. So the first thing they had to get used to was the mud. So here we have a photograph being sent back to Mum of the mud at Steeple Morden which is the 355th Fighter Group, on the right there, and then them standing in front of their barrack block, which were freezing cold. They had one potbelly stove and no real insulation at all. But you can see leaning against the wall the new form of transport that the American GI had to get used to, the bicycle. Well, the first thing that we noticed about them was the wonderful uniforms they wore, particularly the women. They noticed them even more because, A, there were not many British men left in the island. They were abroad fighting, particularly in the Western Desert. And the standard issue uniform for a member of the UK Armed Forces, a non-commissioned member of the UK Armed Forces, was a very hairy, rather rough uniform, and big hobnail boots. No tie, no shirt, collar up to the top. Whereas, as you can see from this enlisted man's bed space, one of the two is sending his mum back a photograph of his bed space. And just look at the kit. He's obviously that day wearing his working overalls because his best and what they call walking out uniform is hanging next to his bed space. No British Army Tommy had anything like the kit that an American brought over with him. Initially American servicemen. And then the lovely photograph on the right, there's a typical letter home photograph, lying in his bunk, writing probably to his mum, maybe to his girlfriend. Let's remember, these lads are in their late teens. The officers, sometimes late 20s, early 30s, the non-commissioned officers, probably mid-teens initially. Of course, promotion got much quicker as they started to, the attrition rate got higher. And they played. That's something that we didn't get used to. Not a very good photograph, this, but it's Bob Hope performing at a concert. They worked hard and they played hard. And that was something that we were not used to. After 2 years, our theatres were open, our cinemas were open, they were very, very busy. But having Hollywood stars coming to entertain troops and things like that was something that was rare for the Brits. They weren't used to the British pub either. They thought, some still do, that our beer was warm and weak. They soon got used to it, though. Primarily because, of course, in most states in the USA, the age for drinking was 21. Well, in Great Britain, it was 16. So young men who had never had the opportunity, or if they had it, was a clandestine opportunity, to imbibe alcohol, were suddenly presented with beer. And they had so much money in their pockets, they could basically buy whatever they wanted. And we'll come to their pay scales in a moment. So they used to arrive at their airbase and immediately go and explore the local area and walk into a pub and find two old men in the pub. Women didn't go into pubs very much in those days. If they did, they had a special bar. They would go into a pub and a couple of old men, farmers or whatever, would be in there. And the Americans, being generous and convivial characters, would stand around for everybody in the pub. And one chap is noted as saying the first time he went in the pub with his friend, he bought a round for two people. The next time, 47 people were there. Weren't they? Let's have a look at them at play. We turn the sound down just a little clearer. They're playing baseball with cricket bats in Hyde Park in London. And they found a few Brits to play with, and they're teaching cricket versus baseball. And you can see their walking out uniform, and their pants, their trousers used to be gold, coloured, and the girls love them, as you can see. And these are enlisted men, often used to get confused by our troops as officers, so enlisted men would be saluted by our officers. And the Brits had to be told exactly what the rank structure and what the badges of rank were for the United States Army Air Force and the United States Army. They loved kids, and they love putting on events for children. And the kids love them because they had candy and Coca-Cola and ice cream. And of course, it was a bit of home. They'd left brothers and sisters behind. It's not the season, the reason is plain as a moon. Health and safety was also, you know. What makes a lady of 80 go out on the men were not, there weren't that many men around, so when men of this age came to an event, then it was a bit like being on the ship. It was great to dance and enjoy yourself to the music that we're listening to. Now, if those cameras hadn't been given to these men, these images would never have been taken. The other thing they couldn't understand was why all our women's legs were red down the front. They thought, and also that our women, and particularly our men, smelt of body odour. The reason the ladies' legs were red down the front was they were so crouched up against coal fires trying to keep warm that they burnt the front of their legs. And of course, you probably know that things like nylon stockings were almost impossible to get hold of, but the Americans could get hold of them. But women used to paint their legs with tea and then get a friend to put a line down the back. But the lasting legacy, let's start with the bad news first. 20,000 illegitimate babies were born. Illegitimate babies were born. But 70,000 British women left the UK in what was called Operation Diaper. They either married and didn't have children, or if they had children, it was called Operation Diaper. They were called the Pilgrim Mothers, and the Red Cross advised them to be alert, adjustable, and ready for change. And, of course, in the United States, they created English Brides Clubs. And it would not surprise me if there weren't some people on this cruise whose parents or whatever met during the Second World War. So the relationship between the two countries was strengthened, because when you think that 70,000 couples now, three generations on, with children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, with relationships with families back in the UK, means it's actually quite massive, the relationship as a result of these young men coming over. And then, of course, after it was all over, they were home at last. Some of them then had to wait for their brides to join them. We have a lovely cartoonist, he died a few years ago, sadly, who used to do cartoons for the Daily Express, who's called Giles. And this is a cartoon he did at the time. And the caption is, "But honey, where did you get the idea that all Americans live in skyscrapers?" But the thing that I'll bring to your attention is, not only is the GI smoking a massive cigar, but so is the baby, which is, and the pipe is being smoked equivalently by everybody in the American family, and the two flags are flying over the log cabin, welcome home Wally and his bride. And this, you know, encapsulates it all, really, as only a cartoonist can do. But let's not forget the sacrifice. On D-Day alone, the US Army lost 4,900 just on D-Day. And the 8th and 9th Air Forces, those young men that you saw standing around telling fighter pilot stories to each other, having come back from a mission, 76,000 of them didn't return. They're still in Europe. Hope you enjoyed that. Got any gum, chums?